Hello, everyone. Welcome to a very special broadcast. I'm Pierre, and you are listening to 93.3 WMMR here in Philadelphia. Ladies and gentlemen, from the heart of Soul Country here in South Philly, we are sending this performance out through Pennsylvania, Delaware, and of course the great Garden State of New Jersey. Not to mention, via WMMR.com, the entire United States of America, indeed the entire planet Earth, are hearing us now. How about that? And so, my friends, with that in mind, will you please welcome home to Philadelphia, live on WMMR, Bon Jovi!
Can I be happy now?
Bon Jovi on 93.3 WMMR. Pierre Robert here as we hang out with the boys on stage and time for a couple little questions. First of all, John, you guys are just about a month into this tour. As I read it, there are 135 shows, 30 countries. It's going to last 2 years. At this point in a very successful career, why do you want to go on such a long tour? You certainly don't have to.
Well, he's divorced.
I'm on a future search. I'm on a worldwide search for my future ex-wife.
So says Richie Sambora. And John has said it's a big world and we still make house calls, which I like as a doctor.
Yeah, you know, I mean, we're 25 shows into the tour so far, and probably another 100 some to go. But, you know, we're having fun. And as long as we're having fun, we're going to keep doing it. And as long as we're making number one albums, you know, then people want to hear them, we're going to go out and perform them.
So. Well, the last tour, the Lost Highway tour, was seen, and I have a little stat on this, by 2,157,675 people. 2,157,675 people saw the Lost Highway tour. It was the highest grossing tour of 2008. When you put together something of this magnitude, is that something that's in the back of your mind? Do you want to top yourself? Do you want to compete with the other big bands, the Stones, the Who?
No. Remember now, we did Lost Highway as an experiment. And then we opened up the arena in Newark called the Prudential Center for 10 nights. And that was going to be the end of it. And because we had so much fun doing it, we decided, okay, well, no one's looking, so let's go across Canada. And that's truly what happened. So now we're at 21 shows, and then I look to Paul and I go, build the stage, let's go. And so we went, and, you know, who knew? Because, you know, our fan base thought, oh, Lord, he's finally snapped, he's down in Nashville now, and they're going to do these, you know, country influence kind of records. But that wasn't the case, and we went down, and Richie and I went down, and, you know, it was a great experiment. And who knew, but it was the biggest tour in the world, bar none. Not, you know, it wasn't the Stones, it wasn't Madonna. Who else was that? The Police reunion, it wasn't Springsteen, it was us. We were the number one tour in the world.
Well, I want to ask you about this, because on this record, it kind of had a similar genesis, too, in that The Circle, the latest record, was actually only supposed to be a couple of songs added to a Greatest Hits album, and then it went so well, you just said, well, let's keep going.
We have issues. Committing issues, you know? Committal issues.
Well, and Richie said, in fact, on this, Richie, you said you described the writing sessions as really easy, prolific, and probably the most fun we've ever had creatively. What made these conditions such that that was the case?
You know what? I mean, John and I just hit a nerve, and then there was a lot of things that were going on in the world all around us, and it gave us great fodder for the lyrical content and also, you know, the stuff that we were feeling as, you know, as we were growing up and stuff like that. You know, we're adults now, so it's a whole different kind of way we look at writing at this point.
Cool. You're here at the Wachovia Center with the great band known as Bon Jovi. Could we get you to do a few more songs?
Sure. Let's get out of the acoustic. Let's do Lost Highway.
Yeah.
About the Philadelphia Soul, because that wonderful institution We got a lot of soul fans here. You took it out of nowhere. Within a few short years, you did what people said could never be done, and we had a world championship on our hand. And then, which is awesome, but then when I never quite followed the de-evolution, if you will, from that point. What exactly fell apart with the league? It wasn't really the soul, it was the league, right?
The implosion. It was sad coming back in this building, you see, because this was our home. And we left it on the highest high, which was winning a championship for the city down in New Orleans. Broke the curse, you know, if you will. And just like anything else in life, you know, what happened with the economic downturn is business went south. And like a lot of other things, it had to restructure. If it was the car industry or arena football, it had to reorganize. And so we went into an involuntary bankruptcy, and another group bought it and took it forward. I don't think that they have the intention of taking the soul name and bringing it here without Craig and Jaws and Leo and myself and Bob and Richie, but they are going to play again. Arena football's happening in other cities. It's just that some other guys own it, and the soul, we left it on top. Well, you know, this isn't a funeral. The way I look at it, it's an Irish wake. We're celebrating a life, not mourning a death. You know.
Well said.
Yeah, a lot of good things came out of it. My friendship, of course, you know, with Jaws and Leo and Mimi Box, who ran it for us. Of course, my partner Craig Spencer, who I made a friend for life there. But most importantly, this old foundation that's come out of it, and because of that. I mean, I'm so pleased that my relationship with Project Home and Sister Mary, and now the Soul Foundation's coast to coast. We've built 250 houses and given away more than $60 million so far. It's all good work.
You mumbled that last line. He said $60
million. No, $6 million. $6 million. We're not that big yet.
Oh, I'm sorry.
$6
million. All right. So you mumbled. I couldn't hear it.
Sorry. I hear good in these monitors.
You're going to be in broadcasting, young man. You have to learn to enunciate. I'm correcting the star of the show. I'm in big trouble now. But the charitable things that wonderful organization did, I mean, before you had played a game, I remind people some $300,000 had been given away to AIDS charities, local schools, every conceivable thing. This is before you even met Sister Mary.
Okay.
Was profound. I mean, talk about investment in this city, a city that desperately needed it. And that team was for all the right reasons. It was inexpensive. A family of four could come out here for a Sunday game and not lose their month's savings. You know, you could come in here and park and have fun and have a great time at the game. Meet the players afterwards. So every purpose that was behind that team was absolutely noble.
I was looking for, role models. It was very important to me that we were building a team that was made of men of character and not characters. Remember one incident when we were standing on the street corners giving away, we don't want them either, T.O., giving these t-shirts a little bit. You know, if you were a character like that, and you were you weren't a good role model for kids and for the city, we didn't want you. We knew we could win a championship without it. And, guys like Matt D'Orazio made that happen for us. So. It was good. It was a good time in my life.
Well, for Soul fans, we tried to include a lot of them in this broadcast, although technically this was fulfilling your promise as you made on the President Steve show, and Nick said, would you do a show for MMR listeners? So we have a lot of MMR listeners here. We have a lot of Soul fans here. And we tried to accommodate everybody. And we also have people listening around, because we're broadcasting this live on MMR, but we have people listening around the country and around the nation, as I said in the introduction, too. What would you say to folks who are out there, Soul fans, Bon Jovi fans who are tuned in right now?
We're doing matinees, folks.
And you're going to do bar mitzvahs next month, I think, right? Up in Sayreville?
That's what it takes. If I open my big mouth, you know, I got to... I'm a man of my word. I'm nothing else if I'm not a man of my word.
Indeed. Also, one thing I want to ask about is the inclusion of fans, because fans are so important. During Living on a Prayer, this amazing screen behind us comes down, and you've been doing a thing where fans can send in videos of them performing the song.
Yeah.
And you've been including them. Have you been surprised by any of the videos you've seen thus far?
I saw this one guy up in Montreal the other day. He looked like a Mickey 6 impersonator.
And I, you know, I got to remember now, I'm looking this way. I'm looking front, you know, at the 20,000 people this way. And I look back and I see the guy biggest life on the screen. I'm thinking, Nikki Sixx submitted a picture of himself somewhere. And I look down in the pit, and sure enough, the guy was down there taking pictures of himself up there. So, well, you made it one way, you know. So, strange enough, but, you know, yeah, it's cool because everybody, you know, one time or another wants to envision themselves up here. And that's just, you know, that's one way of doing it.
This screen, I don't know, for those of you coming tonight and those of you who were here last night, this screen, I've never seen anything like it. The production values present in this giant screen, it's almost impossible to describe. It looks like one big solid screen, but it breaks up into hundreds of pieces, each with its own video content.
Yeah, it's really cutting edge. I mean, our guys did a great job building this stage, and we're really happy with it. You know, I think everybody's been happy with the production that they're seeing.
Cool. Well, could we get you to do a few more songs?
Yeah. Decide whether to do a rarity that we recorded here in Philadelphia in 1985, or a rarity in that I don't sing it all that often, but it was a big monster hit. So, both. All right, so I saw the internet stuff. They wanted me to play Always, which we don't play all that often. Or I was thinking about from the Fahrenheit record that was recorded here in 1985, a song called Only Lonely. So, we'll get to both of them.
Bon Jovi on 93.3 WMMR. How do you make your voice do that?
That's high.
That is high. Didn't you have to learn, relearn how to sing somewhere in the late 80s, early 90s? Because you were blowing your voice out a lot?
I did blow my voice out a lot back in the Slippery era. Yeah, there's a lot of excess. But I met this lady who really showed me the, you know, the technique of singing. So you can do it 3 times in 2 days.
I don't know if we can get a mic to Tico at some point, but I have one question for Tico, if we can get a mic over there. You don't have to be the delivery boy, John, but Tico, first of all, Tico Torres, ladies and gentlemen, I think one of the greatest drummers in rock and roll.
Thank you. How you doing?
And I gotta ask you, Tico, there's an acoustic session of the show where you guys come to the front of the circle last night. You had this big box, and I had no idea what it was. Can you tell us what it was?
Yeah, it's often mistaken for a square guitar, but it's called a cajon. It's a brilliant Brazilian instrument.
Oh, cool.
And we started using it on the circle, and having some fun with it, so we kind of introduced it here to doing something a little quieter, more intimate for the audience and up close.
And Tico's a great singer, by the way. Pick up the box set and you'll find out.
Thank you very much.
That's very true. Lastly, for you, Tico, how's your golf game?
Since we've been working so hard, it's pretty bad. But I'm waiting for some good weather. Thank you very much.
All right, we got to ask David a question as well, because during that same acoustic session, David comes out and you have an accordion on it. Have you used an accordion often in this band?
Often, no. But yes, I have played the squeeze box.
And I believe last night you described it as sexy, which I've never heard described.
I'm bringing sexy back one accordion at a time.
One accordion at a time.
David is an accordion shtick out there. You know?
David is a great musician in his own right and has a number of musicals, including Memphis, which was in Southern California and Seattle, and I believe also off-Broadway, correct?
No, now that's at the Schubert Theater.
Here in Philly?
Memphis, no, the Schubert in New York.
Oh,
no.
There's a Schubert Theater, or there was a Schubert Theater here as well.
Right on Broadway.
Excellent.
October 19th.
And people can find out about it now?
MemphisTheMusical.com.
Cool. And another question for Mr. Sambora. In the...
Yes, my friend.
In the album liner notes, you thank Norm's Rare Guitars, which tells me that you probably have bought...
You should be thanking me.
I'm thinking that because I'm thinking you probably bought a lot of Norm's Rare Guitars.
Yes, I have.
But I'd love to ask you this because this is a guitar question everybody wants to know, and it changes with you every time. Would you have a rough guess as to how many guitars you might own at this point?
Probably about somewhere in the lies of 135.
Wow.
Yes, I've changed my addiction to guitars.
Excellent. I have to say, while we have everybody here too, this man, Mr. Sambora, I think is one of the most underrated guitar players in rock and roll.
Thank you very much.
He's what it's all about. Also, I want to ask you guys about covers briefly. Because you have been known to do a few covers. You've done Neil Young's Rockin' in the Free World. In England you did I Don't Like Mondays with Bob Geldof. Last night you broke into a little Doors. And I understand there's a Kinks tribute album coming out, and John, you are going to sing a song on it. Is that correct?
Yeah, I did Celluloid Heroes, which Ray has sung with the band a couple of times. But yeah, I cut that with him, and Richie's going to play some guitar on it when we get over to England. But Ray Davies has been a good friend and fan and come to shows, and so we've asked him to play with us before. It's a lot of fun.
You also do a Mean Levon on the Elton tribute album.
Elton, great guy, rock and roll.
Great guy.
Yep.
Can we get you to do another few songs?
Yeah.
Or a song or
absolutely.
Whatever you got.
This is this was the name of the movie in the book, but it's my favorite track on the record, and it's called When We Were Beautiful.
Torn, the wind in
so much more. Thank you.
was that's one of my favorite songs from the new album, Work for the Working Man from The Circle.
True story. I was watching 60 Minutes one day, about a year and a half ago now. And the DHL plant in Wilmington, Ohio was shutting down. And the whole town was interdependent on DHL. This little mail pouch, you know, that went around the world was really what was the glue keeping the whole town together, because the restaurants that supported the workers and the tire manufacturers that put the tires on the cars so the people can go to work. When DHL pulled out its American operation and went back to Germany, these very able-bodied American workers were all displaced. And, you know, this lady said, they took my pension. I mean, these were her words. I lost my ID. You know, they took my pension. These were my friends. These were my hopes. These were my dreams. And she says, these were my streets. And I said, wow, I got a song. Here we go. So, you know, we got together the next day.
And the animation that accompanies it when you see it in concert is just incredible.
It's powerful. It's a powerful lyric. But it's State of the Union, you know. We're hovering around 10% unemployment and it ain't getting any easier.
I like to think it's getting better, though. I got one more question for you, sir, and for this band. It seems to me that this group, and I bet that this audience would agree with me, should be inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. Some of the band's okay with it, but it pisses me off, quite frankly. You've got the likes of, you know, Grandmaster Flash. He's in. All right, that's cool, I guess. LL Cool J was nominated. But ABBA is in. With all due respect to ABBA, I got nothing against ABBA.
Jessica ABBA?
But
she should be inducted as far as I'm concerned.
But what about you know, Rush? What about Yes? You know, what about the Moody Blues? And what the hell about Bon Jovi? Sorry. You deserve it.
I agree. You know what? Last year was our first year of eligibility. And, you know, it is what it is, so it's up to that gang of guys up there to decide what it is. But you know what? I have to just say the best is that this is what I do. You know, we got the biggest touring band in the world. At least, you know, that's pretty satisfactory to me. So it'd be nice. You know,
all in good time.
Also,
could we get you to do maybe one more song?
One more song? Sure.
To close out our concert broadcast, because eventually we have to open the doors for tonight's concert as well. And the band is even now huddling to see what they will do. That's the beauty. By the way, has John ever called out an audible that's thrown you guys? You or?
Oh, yeah. All the time.
Because last night, again, Bobby Bandiera went into a little bit of Roadhouse Blues from the Doors. And, you know, just like you guys never cease to amaze me, because this band can play any song. Any cover song, any Bon Jovi song, but I'm just wondering if there's a left turn that's ever been made where you go, I don't know that one. Stump the band.
Oh, yeah, you know, it happens all the time.
I doubt it, to be honest.
No. I just messed around with some yesterday. Mama's got a squeeze box, she wears all the chairs, and when my daddy gets home in L.O.D., over he has, was he playing all night? Hearing music's all right. Dressing room coming out, and then one by one everybody comes in and goes, what are you doing? And I'm doing nothing. Said that on the radio.
I always knew that I liked this place. You don't have to look too far to find a friendly face. I
Second to none. You're the luckiest city in all of America to have a DJ like this on your radio. Pierre Robert, the great MMR, you the kind people of Soulville. I gotta go to work. We'll see you later.
Thank you, John. Thank you, Richie. Thank you, Tico. Thank you, David. Thank you, Hugh. And thank you, Bobby. Ladies and gentlemen, Bon Jovi. We have some other people to thank as the band takes their leave of the stage. We want to thank from Bon Jovi Management, Paul Karzelius, PK, a great man, Jack Grovner, Scott Casey, also the great Obie O'Brien, who mixed this for the radio today, none better, and his faithful assistant, Mr. Mike Rue. From the Wachovia Center, Ike Richmond and his outstanding staff of the Wachovia Center, who couldn't have made us feel more welcome. A lot of the staff volunteered their time to usher you in and out of here today. From our WMMR engineering department, we had Rodney Bird and Steve Lushbaugh, Janice Productions, we thank. And from our MMR staff, Bill Weston and our MMR promotion team, my producer Jason Fayon, I'm Pierre Robert. But above all, ladies and gentlemen, we thank those of you who are here in the hall, all of our listeners, and the incredible Bon Jovi fans in this building, around Philadelphia, around the country, around the world. You rock, and so does 93.3 WMMR in Philadelphia. That concludes this famous special MMR concert event with Bon Jovi. There'll be more tonight in round 3. Thank you for joining us at MMR. Have a great afternoon and a wonderful evening.
Oh. Horizon.
It's not Saturday, April 10th at noon. It's River Police.